Okay, folks, let's go and get started. I'm gonna. We neglected to pull a name out of a hat, but because Kimberly had such a trek, a little drive today, we'll go and start with her for the first question. And Kimberly, I'll ask you the question. You have 3 minutes, and then Eric, you have 3 minutes with the same question. Kimberly, and Eric, when it comes to you, what do you see as the purpose of the California Democratic Party?
So first of all, I wanted to give thanks to everyone who organized this evening. If I could thank Elaine Duvalli, Chris Duvalli, Larry Caballero, Beverly Quarter, Martin Greenridge, Lynn Reese, Catherine George Chu, Chris Robeson, Mark Cross, Mansoor, who is doing the video, the Hubert Humphrey and Yes We Can Democratic Club for co-sponsoring, and of course to Chris Duvalli. Thank you all so much for having us here this evening. I believe that one of the main functions of the California Democratic Party as an institution is to move forward in a bigger, better, bolder way our progressive values as Democrats. It is our responsibility as a party to make sure that our Democratic elected officials hold true and fast to our values and principles as Democrats. As the Democratic Party, we say we are the party of the people. We say we believe in fairness and justice and equity. I believe that it is the responsibility of the California Democratic Party to make sure that every elected official who wears the banner of Democrat, who comes to this party to get our endorsement, who comes to this party to get our money, who comes to this party to get our sweat equity, knocking on doors, phone banking out in the trenches. If you are a Democratic elected official in the state of California, it is your responsibility to be beholden not to the special interests in Sacramento. It is not your job to focus on protecting your incumbency. It is not your job to focus on protecting special money interests. It is your job to do the will of the people of California. That I believe. And one of the main jobs as the chair of the California Democratic Party is to make sure that our elected officials are doing just that.
Good evening, everybody, and thanks to the Yes We Can Democratic Club and the Hubert Humphrey Democratic Club for hosting us all tonight and for all of you for coming out. It's been quite a while in the history of our party since we've actually had an open, competitive race for chair. In fact, since before many of you were born or in this room. The California Democratic Party as an entity is the place where grassroots progressive activists, elected officials, labor unions, and all of the people that make up the big tent of the Democratic Party get to come together. Where we get to work together to set our agenda, where we work together to elect our Democratic majorities, where we set the platform of the Democratic Party, make the endorsements of the Democratic Party, and set the ongoing communication of the Democratic Party. But there's also one other very important group that is essential to the California Democratic Party, and that's the voters. And you see, in California, we've been doing it right. It's the one place in America where we keep electing more Democrats. It's the one place in America where we're passing progressive legislation. It is the one place in America where wall-to-wall Democrats control the state. And it's because we have the best activists, the most talented labor unions, the most committed delegates, some of the best elected officials anywhere in the country. And because we all understand that putting people first is what it's really all about. At the end of the day, we share a core set of values, and in our party, being a big tent, we have some members of our party in elective office who probably strap their guns to their waists when we're not looking, and we have others that probably don't think marriage equality probably should be the law of the land, and we surely probably have a few that have questions about reproductive choice and a few other issues not to mention. We, as the leaders of our party, and by the way, in our party, the leaders of the party is not the chair of the party, or the vice chair of the party, or the controller of the party, but the 3,400 delegates of our party. That's who controls our party. That's who makes the endorsements. That's who adopts the platform. That's who builds the strength. That is why California is as big and blue and progressive as it is.
Okay, next question. Wow. Okay, we'll continue on with Eric right here. What have been, in the most recent years, some of the failures and successes of the California Democratic Party?
If you look at the California Democratic Party as an organization, the first thing you'll probably notice that's missing is we don't have a political director. The second thing that you will probably notice that is missing is that we have no organizers. Hasn't always been that way. It is impossible to successfully break into new territories if we don't have the folks, the resources, and the staff in places to do it. Now, in the last 8 years, we have provided an increasing number of certain types of resources to our local activists, to our local parties, to our local Democratic clubs to help them win elections. And we see it in the outcome of many of those elections. But what we don't have is the professional help of staff who are dedicated to help organize in those areas. The other thing that we've not done a terribly good job about is figuring out how to sit down at the table with our elected officials and our activists to talk about the differences that we sometimes see. When votes are taken and 24 members of the assembly vote against a climate change bill, that's a problem. And what we have to do, and the party has not served this function, is sit down with leaders of our grassroots movement, of our grassroots delegates, along with leaders of our elected bodies, and work this out. And I'll give you, and I realize I'm a bit off on the answer, but it's because I'm very focused on this particular thing. Last year, the leaders of the Rural Caucus came to me and said, we have incredibly important legislation we need to pass. And every time it comes up for a vote, all the legislators from the cities vote against it. I set up the very first meeting between the leaders of the Rural Caucus and urban legislative leadership in Los Angeles and San Francisco. And for an hour and a half, we met in the Capitol. And the net result was we passed the most important piece of legislation, fiscal legislation, to impact the rural communities that had ever been brought forward, and that was the restoration of the PILT funds. Unfortunately, Governor Brown vetoed it, and considering that it was a bill that 78 people voted for and only 2 people voted against, that didn't quite make sense. In any case, that part of what we do has to get better, and we need more of that. And facilitating those kinds of meetings where we activists talk with the elected officials, talk with our union brothers and sisters, talk with the other organizations that are key to our party, and get solutions that work for all of us.
So I would agree, California is doing a lot of things right. I would also agree that we have a lot of work to do. We do keep electing Democrats, but you know what? It's not hard to elect Democrats in strong Democratic strongholds. Where are we in our purple counties, in our red counties, and in our rural counties? I'd like to see our party investing more resources and making sure that we are taking a long-term view, that we are looking at the long-term health of this organization. Maybe not in the next couple campaign cycles, but down the line, we need to be able to turn out strong, viable Democratic candidates in those counties. As the next chair of this party, I will make sure that we not only focus on our safe coastal blue counties, but we are focused on investing in our purple, red, and rural counties for the long term. So yes, we are doing some things right. There's a lot of room to improve. For example, did you know that here in the great liberal progressive state of California, the number of women in our legislature went down in November? California is one of only 9 states in the entire country that has continued to see a decline in the number of women serving in our legislature. We went from 26% to 22%. So what I'd like to see from our majority that we have in the legislature is a real commitment, not just in words, but in deeds, in money, in endorsements, and real resources behind getting more women trained, recruited, running for, and elected to office here in the state of California. And let's talk a bit about the supermajority that we have. I would like to remind all of us that we had a supermajority a few years ago. The question is, for then and for now, what are we doing with that? What are we doing with this supermajority now that we control all of the houses? What are we doing as it relates to getting money out of politics? What are we doing to make sure we close the loopholes in Proposition 13 to redirect those funds back to our public education system? Yes, California does some things good, and we still have work to do. We lead the nation on issues like climate change, marriage equality, pay equity. But where are we in leading the conversation on criminal justice reform, on student loan debt? When it comes to successes, I think there are a lot that we can talk about that California does. In terms of failures and where this party can continue to lead, we need to reinvest in organizing. That is what this party used to be about. We need to get back to developing the next generation of community organizers. Organizers who will, from the Oregon border all the way down to the San Diego border, start recruiting and training organizers who are going to organize around issues in their local communities that help to advance our progressive values. Here in California, California is known as the ATM of this country. Everybody who's running for office all across this country comes to California to raise money. As the next chair of this party, I am going to do what California should be doing, and that is flex our big blue muscle. If you come to California to raise money for your race out in Arkansas, Kansas, or wherever, you better be sure that we want you pushing forward our progressive values wherever you go back to.
Okay, next question. What influences and how can us as a California Democratic Party assist the Democratic National Committee? I'll start with you, Eric.
Well, the first thing we could do is start paying our dues again so that we actually participate in the Association of State Parties. We have the largest delegation of members to the DNC, but we don't even pay our dues anymore to participate in those debates and those discussions. The Democratic National Committee is kind of an odd body, 400-some members. When there's a president, the president has the vast majority of control, appoints the chair, essentially, and sets the policies and directions. When we don't, and we have an independent chair, as we had with Howard Dean, that's when the DNC can actually flourish and do other things. Howard Dean brought the 50-state strategy to America, and it had an impact. And we need a 58-county strategy right here in California. And if I get a chance after a while, I want to address a few of the rural and red issues that were raised, because I happen to have a little bit of experience in that area here in California. But the Democratic National Committee as an entity is made up of people elected from each state. We elect 20 in California. And the chair appoints 70 out of the 400. So when you think about that, the vast majority of the people that are in that body, whose primary purpose seems to be to maintain the presidency or to elect the next president, we need to lay in harder. Remember that the DNC only elects its platform every adopts its platform every 4 years at the national convention. And while we have a great national platform, it's always designed with a mindset that it shouldn't hurt people in the hinterlands. Now, it got a lot more progressive this time than in years past, but it's got a long way to go. And the DNC needs to once again start investing in states. See, the DNC used to pay to put organizers in states all across the country when Howard Dean was the chair. But that stopped. And the DNC used to help organize in places that ran from Alaska to Iowa. But that stopped too. And we need to return to that. And as the biggest delegation with the loudest voice and the biggest congressional delegation, we should be demanding that kind of action. So let me just say this. We have a lot of work ahead of us to repair the damage of the DNC that has occurred in the last 8 years. Because in the last 8 years, the DNC has really gone downhill. But we can start by once again taking a leadership role in the DNC itself and in the Association of State Democratic Parties. Because if we don't have that, our voice doesn't get heard. We don't get to conclude anything with them. We just sort of stand by passively. And that can't continue because we're the ones who can show the way. We're the ones that the entire country looks to because of the fact that this is the biggest, bluest place in America.
The California Democratic Party is the biggest, largest, most influential state party in the country. It is time for us to step into that role in a bigger, better, bolder way. As the chair of the California Democratic Party, there are three things that I will do. Number one, as the chair of this party, I collect checks. I collect checks from people who want to invest in rebuilding this way, this party in a way that is going to be for the long term, making sure that we win elections, not just today, but down the road. Number two, I go on TV and the radio and in the newspaper and talk about our progressive values as Democrats. And thirdly, we flex our big blue political organizing and fundraising muscle. Here in California, we should be able to, at any point in time, flip the California switch such that if we need to deploy bodies on the ground in North Carolina to protest at the Capitol against some of the discriminatory things that they are doing there, we should be able to do that. That is what California should be doing. It's important that we not just think about California. We cannot wall ourselves off from the rest of the country. As the biggest, most influential state party in the country, we must flex our muscle. We must make sure that we are building a big blue wave that is going not just here in California, but it is washing over the entire country. That is what the California Democratic Party can do to make sure that the DNC is leading in the way that it should be. Everybody knows that as California goes, so goes the nation. It is time for us to show not just the DNC, but the rest of this country the way to lead, not just for the future, but the resistance.
Okay, we'll stay with Kimberly on this one. Okay, if you're elected to the chair of the California Democratic Party, number one, do you agree with corporate funding to the party? And then number two, if you don't, how do you propose to eliminate that from the process of electing officials?
Yeah. So I propose to lead the California Democratic Party in the way that I am leading my campaign. To date, in the 18 months that I have been running this campaign, we have raised over $250,000 from 500 individual and unique donors. Not one penny of that has come from special corporate interests. Not one penny of that has come from big tobacco. Not one penny of that has come from big pharma. Not one. Not one penny of that has come from big oil. If we want to wean ourselves off of big corporate special interests, the one thing that we can do as a party is to get back to basics. As an institution, I believe that we have forgotten who we are. We have forgotten what we stand for. We have forgotten our values. It's the reason why most people here today in California are registering as declined to state. They are not registering as Democrats because they don't see a big difference between the parties. It is time for us to redefine what it means to be a Democrat, to remind people we are the party of the people, but in order to do that, we have to get back to the people, being about the business of the people. People will invest in this party if they see value, if they see relevance, if they see us doing what we were put here to do, and that is to be a voice for the voiceless and to be the people. The money is there. People are ready to invest in something they believe in. I am running to bring a new voice, a new perspective, and a new style of leadership to this party that says that if you are an elected official, it is not just expected that you will do the work of this people, but it is demanded of you. People are ready to invest in that.
You know, we have to acknowledge things that are good when things are good. Voter registration in the Democratic Party in California is not decreasing, it's increasing.
It's the boom!
Voter registration in California is decreasing in the Republican Party, and it's decreasing among declined to state voters. That may be true, but the fact is Democratic voter registration has been on the upswing for the last 2.5 years in California, not on the downswing. And that's an important difference. And I just want to say this. As a matter of funding our party, you know, our party does $40-plus million a year to run all the races that we do. This past year, we spent $100 million on races up and down this state. That's a lot of money. And yes, I agree with you. We should have passed the clean money bill 3 different times by now. We should have done that long ago. And I think most Democrats support that. And I think it is time that we keep it at the forefront. But we also understand that our union brothers and sisters are among the biggest supporters of our party. And they contribute tens of millions of dollars to our party. And the very basis of progressivism came from collective power of unions. And if we really care, we should be talking about what we do to restore unions, because they're our partners that help us win. And that's what's important. And California is leaving on progressivity. The fight for 15 started here. It's been won here. Criminal justice reform. How many hundreds of thousands of people have been released from prison under Governor Brown's reassignment bill? We just passed another major bill to reform our criminal justice system here. We are doing extraordinary things here. And it's okay to say we want more and we want better, but we cannot denigrate the good work that's being done. And good work is being done. And we turned the Affordable Care Act into the most successful healthcare program imaginable, 3.8 million people alone in this state. And we proved that you could have a system like that that worked. However, when I worked with Senator John Garamendi in 1988, when I worked with Sheila Kuehl not once but twice, when I worked with Senator Mark Leno on his single-payer bill, that's what we should have done, that's what we should have passed, that's what California deserves, and that's what we should be leading with. And by the way, all three of those authors of single-payer bills in California's legislature support me.